Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this session on the role of multipurpose hydropower in a water-stressed world. We're going to try to make this an interesting session. At least we have four very interesting guests who will, as discussion leaders, try to set the tone. And then it's my responsibility to also to draw you back here in the discussion, and then for myself, if that is the case, to play a little bit the devil's advocate. Let me first introduce very quickly the panel members. I will introduce them a little bit more, but only a little bit more, whenever they make their own introductory statement. But I would like to tell you, if you want to read more about these gentlemen, then go to the website, and their whole bio data and their company description is on the website, so there you can find all the details. So from also from your left to the right, and who you see is, and by the way, I'm going to make it easy for everybody here. I'm going to leave out the titles, if you don't mind, then I can't make a mistake, then they're all misters, okay? Sorry to say, but there's no misses on the panel, but then I don't make any mistake. So the first one is Mr. Albert Melo. Well, his name is a bit more complicated, and this is the second name, but the real last name seems to be Melo. Okay, fine. Then Mr. Ernst Zeller. I think he's the next one. Then Mr. Richard Taylor and Mr. Simon Rossi. Okay, and I'll come back in a second. So the way that the session goes is that you've had already a few sessions like this. There are some questions that we have asked the discussion leaders to think about. How can the sector best manage the increasing competition for water? Second is, what are good examples on how the sector can manage more regular droughts and extreme weather events? And thirdly, is regional integration a critical condition to further support the development of hydropower projects? That reminds me that maybe on the program, or at least on my sheet here, there was a fifth speaker also announced, but he regrettably cannot make it. Okay, but I can assure you, normally speaking, even the five of us, we can have enough fun if you also cooperate with that. Let me then just start with a few comments myself. And when I start thinking about, okay, this title, then I would say, well, first of all, when it's put more and more on the agenda these days, that's the energy-water nexus. But it's very clear that energy-water nexus is very, very different depending on the region in the world. So you have certain regions where, indeed, it's not really too much of an issue. For others, it's crucial. Typical example is this, indeed, and Ireland versus, let's say, the Middle East. Okay, if you then focus it more on hydro and water, of course, then in the Middle East there is not too much to do because of the you need elevation for that. But you have likewise issues, let me put it that way, that in certain areas it's more of an issue than in others. It also depends on the magnitude and the scale at which you employ then hydro facilities. Now, it seems to be clear that you will need these facilities both for electricity generation, and also that you will have to do some kind of water management. If that has not been the case in the past, then it certainly will have to be that case. But again, it needs to be locally evaluated. But of course, there are now, and the older people in the room, we have already noticed that indeed, that we have seen changing weather patterns over the last 30, 40 years or something like that. So I also have to admit, the weather pattern also where I live is somewhat different than when I grew up as a kid. So these are things that we have to take into account. Now, when we come to security of supply, because it was also mentioned in the description of the session, I think it's important that we make a distinction between security of supply, let's say, on the short term and the long term. The short term would then mean that you can also use then hydropower, and maybe also then, or some extent then, if it is then pumped hydro, which is then, let's say, a derivative, let's say, of the first one. that is done for short-term balancing in let's say in power markets, but clearly there's also then the need for long-term, and then you actually are talking then in terms of energy, the amount on an annual basis that you your reservoirs that you need and need enough water. But also there again, it depends on where you're talking about this thing, so on the diversity. Now, what I also would like to, I'm not sure whether we have time to bring it up, but there was a time when also, it was mentioned in the plenary this morning, that for instance, for certain regions, certain areas, like especially Africa, that there was the dream, or there is the dream, of these very huge hydropower facilities like the Inga in Congo, and then have high voltage lines crossing the continent. Is that still something that is a sensible idea for certain regions of the world or not? And then finally, I think, and but you are much more placed than better placed than I am, public acceptability. I'm actually surprised to read that even in Europe, for sometimes for smaller facilities, hydro facilities, that also there is so much protest, local protest, that in the end you say, well, what do people still want? They don't want to have this and that and that and that. I'm not going to name any names, but anyway, that's the issue. So there seem to be more than enough to talk about. And if I first may ask, so the order in which we're going to address the issues is first somebody from industry, so Mr. Simon Rossi from EDF. Then we go to a big consultant company, Mr. Zeller from Austria. And then we have on this side, Mr. Melo, basically a research institute. And then we come to Mr. Taylor, Richard Taylor, an association of the hydro, so that we have actually the full line, and then we'll see how these gentlemen agree or disagree, and then we'll take it from there. Okay, so first one is Mr. Simon Rossi. He is, let's say, the regional or the vice president for regional, let me just see, get this right. Yeah, by the way, I forgot to introduce myself. My name is William Dasler. I'm university professor, full-time university professor working on energy systems integration, so everything together, with a background in several of the energy carriers. And then I'm also the chair of the Belgian World Energy Council committee. Mr. Rossi, and I'm trying to find his, here we are. So he's with the EDF group, and he's group senior vice president of the international division. Okay, he is somebody who comes from the, let's say, the business administration type of background, has been chief financial officer also in a particular company, and then he became also CFO then in EDF Energy, and he's now has responsibility for several of the branches internationally of EDF. Mr. Rossi, you have the floor, please.
Thank you, William. Thank you, everybody, for being here. So I'd like to... Why am I here as EDF? First, because I've been invited. Thank you for inviting. And second, because hydro is a crucial component of our strategy. The new CEO of EDF, which is actually not new anymore because it has been there now for nearly 2 years, that when he came, he did the exercise that from time to time happens when new CEOs arrive, so refreshing the strategy of the company. And hydro development was made a central pillar of our strategy. Now, developing hydro in France, of course, where the home base of EDF is, the opportunities are quite limited. And so it means internationally, it means elsewhere. And interestingly also in EDF, from an organizational point of view, the hydro department, which has always been part of the production department, sitting alongside nuclear generation and thermal generation, it has been carved out and made it to report to the same person in charge of EDF Energie Nouvelle, which is the company that develops wind and solar, as if to stress the fact that hydro, after all, is the oldest renewable energy form, and it has its full role to play, together with these other forms, for the decarbonization of the world. I'd like to say just two things. The first is why we believe in hydro, SEDF, and MEB. Why do we think we have something to say in this sector? And the first, we believe in hydro because, well, first of all, hydro power plants, if properly designed and maintained, last a long time. We are talking about a century or even more. So when we talk about sustainability, sometimes it's a philosophical concept, but, you know, if you build something that after a century is still running, well, that is the beginning of something which is sustainable, because you don't have to replace it after maybe 20 or 30 years. The second reason is very much something that I think the other panelists will cover much better than I do, but hydro is curious because it's not just electricity, it's lots of things. A hydro plant can turn out to be a tool to regulate the flow of rivers, prevent floods, and there are also downsides as well, but let me say it's regulating water is something that can serve many purposes beyond electricity generation. The third reason is that hydro is a vector of development for economies, for the countries which adopt it. First of all, in construction phase, the investments, the largest share of investments are local, is civil works, which are done locally. And then once it's built, of course, the electricity produced could either displace imported fuels or be exported itself. It generates wealth in the country where it is developed. And finally, it's low carbon. So I would say it contributes, not always, not under all circumstances, let me say, but if properly done in the emissions linked to hydro reservoirs can be kept to a very low level, and also it's genuinely low carbon. So that's why we believe in it. And then why do we think we have something to say, aside from maybe being slightly arrogant, so we hope we are not arrogant, but EDF actually had a fantastic experience in Laos, hydropower plant of Namteum 2, which is a 1,000 megawatts power station built, whose construction was completed about 5 years ago. And normally when you comment on these type of things, you comment on how much production, how much financial return, how much whatever. So I'm just going to share with you two or three statistics about the impact of this hydro plant. The first is that school attendance rate in the people of the Nakai Plateau, which is the area where this plant was developed, and unfortunately we had also to resettle 6,500 people, which is a difficult task. So the school attendance rate was 30% before the project, and now these people, school attendance rate is 90%. The infant mortality rate before the project was 105 over 1,000 live births. So it was really very, very high because people lived essentially without any form of support or assistance. And it's now 46 over 1,000. So it's still very high, but it's cut in half. The 100% of the resettled households are officially above the poverty line now. They all live of fisheries or farming or forestry, other activities which have been developed. They all have electricity, of course, which they didn't before. That seems logical, but... So, briefly, I would say that with this example, that not just producing electricity or fostering the industrial development of a country, and of course I'm not mentioning some of the flip side, of course, there will be also some drawbacks, but there are also opportunities for really contributing to the development of a community which chooses to host such a sometimes invasive, a bit invasive infrastructure that could actually represent a significant opportunity. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We go now straight to the next speaker, that's Ernst Zeller. Ernst is regional director, let's say global head marketing and sales for hydropower and renewable energy, then of Pyri Energy, which is a big consultancy company. And he has a background, well, in the European market and also including Turkey and Georgia. And he has a background in mechanical engineering and has been since 2004 with Pyri. Please, you have the floor.
Thank you, William. We, as an engineering consulting company, we are developing hydropower since decades, and Austria has a long-lasting experience. And I would like to underline the statement before about hydropower as renewable energy. We know that hydropower, altogether, we are talking about 22% of the energy production comes from renewable, and 60% out of it is hydropower. So hydropower is still a very dominant, important factor in renewable energy worldwide. Nevertheless, we see clearly two facts which are accompanying us in the development of hydropower. One is the interaction, the clear interaction between water, energy, and food. And the other is clearly the global, the mega trends we see which coming to us, which forcing us. It's the typical mega trends like climate change, like urbanization. A lot of people are going to these urban areas. And the third one is clear is digitalization. So these are three megatrends affecting our business, our development of hydropower bunch more and more. And just to have some figures, we see when we develop hydropower that agriculture still needs around 70% of the total water availability, and it will increase by 50 to 60% in the next 30 years. So there will be, on the other side, a big increase of consumption of electricity by 50% in the next decades. And the withdrawal for irrigation will become more and more important. So in this surroundings, in this framework, we have developed, together with our client, worldwide hydropower plants. And we see it just as a challenge to develop this, to take this these challenges and to develop new perspectives, new ways how we can optimize the development and the design of hydropower plants. One important issue is for sure the climate change, as I mentioned, and for us it's very much important to play a very important role to use all available technological material we have, starting from satellite meteorological stations, precipitations, and here we are developing, optimizing schemes of hydropower plants in a very long run. We can even adapt the hydro runoff from the past and make quiet, reliable forecasts for the future. And this forecast for the future brings us to a very important topic from the climate change. We see a lot of more droughts, a lot of more floods. But by taking this information we get from this international data, we can already predict quite heavily impacts of the environment, like big droughts, like seasonal droughts, like global effects like El Nino. So we have programs that we can see the El Nino effect and can help the client to optimize then the runoff river developments and the operation of the power plant itself. So by taking this technology, it becomes more and more effective for us to adopt and develop and optimize the overall operation and of hydropower plants. Another aspect which I would like to mention is the optimization in the design. So in former times, hydropower was purely used as electricity generation, but now the requirements are completely changing. So there are more effective in primary and secondary energy. A lot of hydropower plants have the black start capabilities, which helps us really to have a stable and reliable grid system. Because when you have heard a lot about the changes and smart grids and renewable, we see the stability will be a major issue in the coming decades. And one of these issues will be that you have the backup availability of reasonable hydropower plants that you can immediately effect and start and stabilize the grid, which cannot be done, of course, by renewable energy in general. So the overall capacity in these technologies will go more in this direction of stability and manage of grid stability and flexibility. One important fact as well I have to mention is that we are working clear in cooperation with environmental parties. For us, it's a must to have all these environmental inputs in place to optimize the fish migration and to optimize as well the release of sediments. This is a topic, so we cannot design any hydropower anymore without really taking into consideration what will be with the sediment during the operation and what will happen to the fish and the aquatic animals. So all these facts is challenging us in the development of hydropower plants. And nevertheless, as I mentioned, hydropower is a very mature technology and it will have its role in the next coming years. And therefore, I'm quite confident that we are playing an interesting and important role in the overall energy mix for the world.
Microphone. Thank you. Okay. Now, next in line is then we go to the research institutes, Albert Mello and or De Mello. And I understand that he's the general director of the Electric Energy Research Center, which is abbreviated as CEPEL, and it's the largest electrical energy research institution in South America. It seems like it has been established by several members, and his background, let's say, to make it short, is all branches of, let's say, electrical engineering, especially in the power sector. Okay, please, you have the floor.
So thanks, Ms. Hassler, for the nice introduction. So I would say that the integration between hydropower development and river basin water resource management is crucial in deal with this next between electricity, energy, and water. To achieve this, I believe that first we have to have an enabling policy framework and also tools to provide quantitative support for decision making. I mean methodologies, I mean simulation and optimization tools. I also would say that this interlink could not be treated in a project by project base. We have to have a holistic approach. So the mutual use of the water should be considered since the very first phase of planning procedure. That is head division or inventory hydropower in the river basin. Because that's a key step towards sustainability. And also should be continuous until operational level. So in that sense, Brazil, and specifically CEPEL, the research center I work for, we have developed a chain of simulation optimization tools for the whole country. I don't know if you're aware, but in Brazil, we are continuing to have a single national operator system. We have to have a planning activity for the whole country. So we have developed large-scale optimization models to deal with that. And one of these is our manual for hydropower inventory river basin that was sponsored by Brazil government and the World Bank. You can download it from freely from our website. And the objective here is to find a balanced solution between cost-effective power production, social environmental impacts, not only negative but positive ones, and of course the multiple use of the water. So it's a multi-objective approach. For example, we consider scenarios for future water use that comes from our National Water Resources Development Plan. On the other hand, the other water uses like water supply, irrigation, navigation are treated as positive impacts. So head division is key at the first phase. Another example in the institutional framework in Brazil is in the feasibility studies. We have an auction system, and a project to be elected to the auction procedure, they have to have its feasibility study approved, have to have the preliminary environmental license approved, and to get this, we have to obtain from the water regulatory agency, we call the declaration of water availability. What is the amount of water for electricity? What is its seasonal regime? One example that I can share with you is the feasibility study of Belo Monte Power Project that's under construction. It's 11.2 gigawatts total capacity. And during the feasibility phase, we have to have a special outflow regime to cope with some endogenous turtles in that areas. What's necessary, on the other hand, we have to reduce around the 200 megawatts of the installed capacity because of that. A question that is still open is how to allocate cost and benefits among the users of the multipurpose reservoirs. So it's something that we have to work out. Regarding extreme events, I would say that, of course, it impacts not only hydropower, power system, the whole infrastructure. And once again, I would say that you need good data, but you have to enhance our analytical tools to better consider climate and weather events or variables. I mean that there is still a gap between climate models and power system model, even for hydrothermal optimization models. You have to reduce this. And if you have uncertainty around the inflows to the reservoir, the uncertainty around the weather models are even higher when you consider medium term and long term. So we have to shorten this. I'll say forecast capabilities is quite important. And in terms of interconnected system or a continental system like Brazil, hydrological diversity should be taken into account. It's quite important to deal with extreme events. One example that I can share with you is in the recent years, Brazil has been experiencing a drought situation, a hydrological bad situation in the main power production regions in Brazil. We're using our models for optimizing the dispatch. We have to have a strict optimization of that. Then the power cycle calls to alleviate or to reduce the minimal outflow of San Francisco River in the northeastern part of the Brazil for the Sobradinho power plant. By the water regulatory agencies, 1,300 cubic meters per second for other uses. But because of the hydrological situation, because of forecast capability, that we would imagine by using this tool that this drought would last longer, we call that. So the first reaction for other users was, I'd say, lots of complaint, almost a nightmare, because they say they're being affected only because of hydrothermal optimization. As time goes by, now we see that they have been applauding this decision that the process made because we reduced from these 1,300 cubic meters per second by now 800 cubic meters per second, and now we have some water storage in the reservoir being used for other uses. We are we are interconnected, we are complemented from the other regions and also from thermal power plants. And finally, last year in the south, although the north region is in very bad situation because of the El Niño phenomena, we experienced high level of inflows in the southern region. Once again, with our flood control models, we were able to provide spare capacity in the reservoirs to receive that amount of water that would come. And we minimize a lot downstream consequence. So that's by now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Very interesting. And now finally, we go to the representative of the, let's say, the Hydro Association. So the chief executive of the International Hydropower Association, IHA. Based in the United Kingdom, and that's Richard Taylor. IHA, I understand, is a non-profit organization active in more than 100 countries, and it is indeed, and its role is to provide a strong, credible voice for the future role of hydropower at all levels. Okay, he's a fellow of the UK Energy Institute and has written several papers and edited on water and energy. Richard, you have the floor, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, William, and good afternoon. I think that it's difficult to be the last in an order of speakers to bring something new to the discussion, so I'll do my best to talk about a couple of points with regard to the challenge and also some couple of points around the solutions as far as we can bring forwards today. So with regard to multipurpose hydropower, I think it would be useful to think about those purposes in three dimensions. First of all, and most obviously, are the power system services that hydropower can bring. Renewable electricity, low carbon electricity, but also system support services. Firming capacity for variable renewables, and also providing system stability also in the availability, storage, and quality of supply in the electricity system. Downstream purposes are what comes to mind most quickly when we think about multipurpose hydropower. We think about the water supply, the irrigation, the availability of water to ensure that minimum flows do not cause problems downstream in times of low water availability. But also we need to think about activities upstream as well. Increasingly, reservoirs have important roles to play, and upstream in the catchment. Sometimes these roles actually supersede over time in terms of the value that the asset is bringing, then supersede the original purpose of the electricity generation. So we have these kind of three dimensions of multipurpose hydropower, and these opportunities can be built into projects, and they can also be built out of projects. And I think that's something I'd like to have the opportunity for some discussion around, that depending on the public-private structuring, markets and incentives, these projects can be multipurpose, they can deliver on a whole range of services, but only if the conditions are encouraging to develop and operate projects in that way. The second point I would like to make is that multipurpose projects are complex and involve a great number of stakeholders. The planning process is expensive and requires significant trade-offs in relation to optimizing power, water, food, climate, environmental services. They should be driven by a system approach. Systems from the point of view of electricity systems, but also from a basin approach as well. And this is a complex process. And Albert mentioned from the point of view of Brazil how complex a challenge meeting these system needs can be. They have to be done, though. To do allow projects from a point of view of single project optimization is only going to either miss opportunities or potentially bring problems to those systems. So planning costs a lot of money, and there has to be an equitable share of the risks of the costs involved with planning projects, making them fit for investment, fit for finance, and fit for the systems in which they serve. So ultimately, this cost has to be shared. The developer should inherit this cost once there has been a thorough planning to the point of which permitting, acceptability, finance can be achieved, so that the expenditure on planning isn't done at the high risk of no project being the outcome. Current thinking about hydropower support facilities in regional and national contexts is an area of work that I think is very interesting to allow for this equitable sharing of risk in the preparation of projects. And the last point I'd like to make is that policy and markets should reward multipurpose benefits. If they don't, it's going to be extremely difficult to encourage the private sector to deliver around services for which there's no financial return. And the expectation from the international financing institutes is that there is the vast majority of hydropower development will be through the private sector, so we have to make sure that services that are delivered have some kind of encouragement and incentivization. The green market has a much, much larger role to play in driving forwards multipurpose hydropower. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. May I ask you to turn off the mic, please? Thank you. Is there any of the panel members who wishes to respond to anything that you have heard by your colleagues? Not quite? Okay. I have a few questions that I would like to address to you, and you take them in whoever wants to address them now. I think it was Simon who also mentioned then aspects in developing countries. But isn't it, and I tried to link that and also a little bit with public acceptance, isn't it so that at least that's what I would think, that going ahead with new projects and new projects of considerable scale, that they seem to be more acceptable in developing countries than in developed countries, because the public acceptance in developed countries seems to be much, much more difficult, whereas in developing countries, if you then also can offer the water management or actually make that as a point, irrigation and then agriculture related to it, and similarly then also then avoiding of floods or controlling of floods, that the benefits, the opportunities for those types of people seem to be larger or outweigh the disadvantages that indeed then, yeah, some of these big projects may have. That's the first thing I would like to say. But on the other hand, then the developing countries, if you have to invest in a major project, how are you going to do the financing? Is it doable as a private company to do that? I would say you can probably, maybe if you can find the financing, only do it if you're sure that you're working in a stable market environment and that you have some kind of guarantee, because these are things that are built for 50 to 100 years. So what is your return on investment? Or is this only possible in a PPP, so public-private partnership, these types of things? So I've actually thrown a few questions together, but who wants to take or provide, try to provide an answer to these types of issues? So what I feel, and that's my that's with my belly, that it's not with my, necessarily with my brains that that I feel this, but the relationship between developing and develop, is it the right feeling that I have, or could somebody respond to that? Who wants to take the floor? Okay, please. So Ernst, and then we'll just see how it.
Maybe I can respond. That we are developing hydropower plants, of course, mainly in emerging countries. And it's clear on the one side, when we talk about Western Europe or the Western developed countries, the hydro potential is already quite limited. So the major major efficient hydropower plants has been built. And so in emerging countries, they are still, it's a development factor of the economy. And therefore, they, it's quite much easy to develop hydropower plants in these emerging countries. I would not say developing countries, more emerging countries, because this is much more effect on the population, on the economy, and the development of the labor, and in general. What we see, and would bring in this factor, we heard in the last days a lot of to talk to each other between different countries. And in the hydropower development as well, it's very, very important that the different stakeholders are developing together some processes, some use, water usage rights, and mainly in cross-border regions, because mainly rivers are forming borders, and therefore it's much more complicated to develop together or one country some projects. So communication is here essential, as we have heard in the last days, communication between the stakeholders, between the governments, between the finances, to have the process going and to have the possibility to develop projects in general.
Somebody else willing to take that? The financing of these big projects, and then also the rate of return on these things, or is it necessary that, let's say, the state is involved in these things? Is it quasi impossible to do it as a simple private company, or who can take that? Or
I take the opportunity maybe to come back 1 second, still on the topic of acceptability, and just saying that I was a few weeks ago in a small village. 50 kilometers north of Yaoundé, the capital city of Cameroon, a village called Bachenga, where, in this case, EDF has been operating an office for 3 years now, and working on detailed mapping, so village by village, family by family, reviewing the trajectory of the high voltage line that we would need to deploy. Is a 50 kilometers line, so it's nothing massive, it's nothing astronomical, and of course on the area where we are intending to build this power plant. I would say that in terms of acceptability, there are no shortcuts. There are no shortcuts, and without a real deep, detailed work on this, no plants could ever come out of the ground, no matter where they are. That's our experience, our belief. Now, when it comes to financing, I would say the issue is that Mother Nature has created, you know, rivers and falls, which have been already exploited in countries where there is the wealth to pay for it. And they haven't been yet exploited in countries where, for the Murphy's Law, most of the times, actually, there is a lack of financial resources. And, you know, people, yeah, they pay electricity, but they pay very, very little. And, you know, the grids are leaking and et cetera, et cetera. So the developer of these projects will always face a huge challenge financing these projects. It means granting the revenues of these projects. And in practical terms, it's hard to tell, but in the real projects that we are working on for the time being, there is no other solution than to seek the support, the participation of multilateral institutions, such as the World Bank and similar institutions, that they only can ultimately provide the type of guarantees that would be required for the investors to proceed.
Okay, Albert, you want to say a few words?
First, talking about financing, I would say that, of course, solutions and policy depends on country circumstances. Just to share one example, Brazil, that in Uruguay and South Africa have been also noticed, all auction systems. So we have an auction procedure to procure energy for consumers, we call captive consumers. Then a project that goes to auction, a hydropower project, has to have, as I mentioned, a preliminary environment license. We go to auctions, and the winner, that one, they offer the least cost per kilowatt hour. What it receives in these auctions? A contract, a portfolio contract with all distribution companies in Brazil. By now it's 70. So they receive a very stable cash, future cash flow that does not depend on the operation itself. With the very stable cash flow, you can access banks for financing your project. Of course, the project should be bankable and not to go to the auction system. So you have a stable future cash flow. That's a key aspect. And we have succeeded in providing a large amount of renewable energy in Brazil. You go for, not only for hydro, but the wind, solar, grid connected, and the, of course, the thermal power plants. That's one aspect. The other point about the public acceptance, at least in Brazil, there are lots of misleading information communication. So lots of NGOs put wrong information and make a mess with the public. One example is regarding, for example, GHG emissions from hydropower reservoirs. So through IEA, the CPL chair of task force, and for IEA, with Richard, we have been developed procedures, guidelines for measurement and analysis of GHG emissions. We did field campaigns, for example, in Brazil, there was some information that took away power plant, it's now 8.2 gigawatts, has been emitting GHG gas 4 times more than a coal-fired thermal power plant. So after 2 years of work, we proved scientifically that is not the case. The emission is 20 up to 30 times less than a coal-fired thermal power plant, in the same levels as, for example, Eastman 1 that is in Canada, in cold area. So there are some attempt to block hydropower development in tropical areas. So we have to communicate much, much better. We are failing on that.
In all honesty, I think that's a little bit the problem in the whole energy issue, that there's so many opinions these days, and especially, I'm sorry to say so, there's so many people who are actually lying and are actually distorting figures, all kinds of things. So that's why I appreciate also that all kinds of institutions and research institutions especially just go for the right numbers and communicate them, and I think that's what we have to do. And then what do then associations do with that, Richard? Please give a few comments on what I said.
Yeah, so I'd like to speak to both the acceptability and the financing point. On the acceptability, it's been a long history of public opinion around hydropower that has been negative in many parts of the world. A lot of the lenders are heavily pressurized around ensuring that environmental and social standards are acceptable and transparent and reported around. For that, we worked for many years following the World Commission on Dams with the United Nations Environment Programme on a project called Dams and Development, and following on from that, produced a hydropower sustainability assessment protocol, which is a measurement tool for sustainability performance in project development. It covers the life cycle from the early stage planning, construction, and operation. And that tool is being used to report to lenders and decision makers for bringing an independent assessment of the project in terms of its sustainability performance. So tools do exist for doing this type of reporting to ensure that there's some kind of more informed discussion about the social and environmental positives and negatives of a particular project. One of the guys is sitting in the audience who was involved in the forum, Gudni Johansson from Iceland, sat on that forum, so he might bring some knowledge around that. On the financing challenge, certainly hydropower is a complicated project to bring forwards in terms of its generic characteristics. It has extremely high upfront costs, and consequently that's a deterrent for a large part of the electricity development industry. To further complicate it, there is a dynamic of changing expectations. Albert mentioned the freshwater management challenge as being, in some cases, more significant than the electricity component. How do we finance projects that are multi-purpose in nature, recognizing that there's a market for some of those services and not for others? Some of the IFIs are bringing out tools and options around blended finance, where concessionary rates are given for components of the project that are have more societal value, and commercial rates are given for those parts of the project that will bring services to market. Of course, we still, on an international level, especially in the developing world, one of the biggest concerns is the foreign currency risk, and that really is something that there aren't too many affordable solutions to mitigate. The insurance industry is very happy to discuss with developers about managing this, but in some way trying to ensure in the project's development multiple streams of income, and they can be potentially through long-term power purchase agreements in a more reliable currency, at least as a part of the project package. And also somewhat limited at the moment is the carbon revenue stream. The Clean Development Mechanism drove many thousands of projects around the world, bringing a US dollar revenue stream for certified emissions reductions. And I still believe that ultimately this is an important possibility under a different description in the future. We have to also remember the difference between finance and investment, and the appetite for investment changing over the life cycle of a hydropower project. Financing is extremely difficult to get a project off the ground, but we have to think about refinancing once you've built the project, because by that stage, normally everyone is your friend, as opposed to everyone being your enemy. And refinancing at that post-commissioning stage is another way of managing the finance challenge, getting better terms once you've got the asset operational. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. We have about 15 minutes left, so I would like to go first to the audience. I understand there is a microphone, or there are some microphones in the room. Could we have the microphones, please? And if not, then you just speak a little bit louder. But I understand that there are. And if you ask all the questions, that's easier for me. Then we can... But in all honesty, it's for you that we're doing this, and please feel free to ask the questions. Just state where you come from, or who you are, where you come from, to whom the question is addressed, or the comment. And then we'll see. Are there any microphones? Yes? Yeah, here, please, in the front. Could you raise? Yeah, that's the, he was first. Then it's 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, whoops, okay, good.
Yeah, William.
Yeah.
I have a question to you.
Oh.
We have here a nice European table discussing the whole of multipurpose hydropower. Would it be not more appropriate to have people like Canada, Russia, China, some South Americans, some Africans, they still have hydro potential to develop?
Do you want to have a diplomatic answer or the real answer? No, in all honesty, the program was ready. I did not have any. But as a matter of fact, if you just look at it, it's not quite true. There,
I think it's a question more to WEC.
No. Wait, yes. No. The point is, there was somebody from Russia who was supposed to be here. He wasn't the he was supposed to be here. He was actually the, or he is the CEO of the biggest a hydro company and a generator in Russia. Then, as a matter of fact, although he's based in the UK, Richard is actually representing not only a European thing, he's basically representing the whole thing in the whole world. And I think there are two other gentlemen, indeed, I'm from, well, this guy from Brazil, you know him, I suppose, and he's not from Europe. And then you have the two European ones, but for what they're actually sitting here is more, I haven't heard them much talking about Europe, it's more indeed than their projects that they were doing abroad. But I take your point. I will pass on the message to the WEC organizers that indeed. Okay, fine. Who was then? I think it was you, the gentleman there. Yeah, indeed, please.
Günay Köse, I'm from Turkey. We own hydropower plants, and normally we are happy that we own hydropower plant, but it seems there is no concession on what is renewable energy. Like when we hear renewable energy, usually people talk about solar and wind energy, and it seems like only hydro people usually talk renewable energy as hydro. And I think that we need a definition, a criteria to define what is renewable, what is not. So maybe the best person is Mr. Zeller, actually. Do you think, is there any criteria that we can measure projects, what is renewable, what is not, and can we say solar is more renewable than wind or than hydro? I think this is my question.
Let me first say something as a neutral person. I think we, and it's again the same thing in that the energy field, we're actually fighting a lot of perception. For me, it's pretty clear. Hydropower is renewable, period. Whether you like it or not, well, you don't have to not like it. It is what it is. That's what the definition is of renewable. Basically, it's a continuous stream where, of course, you have to take into account that, well, if I say a continuous stream, of course, when it's night, the sun doesn't shine either. When it is indeed a bit dry and these things, the same thing happens then to hydropower. And if you actually look at it, most of the statistics, when you look at the statistics worldwide of renewable energy, of course, you have the non-commercial biomass that is still dominating everything. But second, by far, and certainly in the electricity sector, it's hydro. If it hadn't been for hydro, then the statistics for so-called renewable energy would have been very, very small at this moment. So I think it certainly deserves the place there. What indeed is the case that now these days it's a fashion to only talk about the more sexy, the more modern renewables, and that's the wind and sun. But I think you shouldn't give up. It's hydro is renewable, and indeed it has also some disadvantages here and there with some greenhouse gas emissions that are not zero. But the same, as a matter of fact, is true for solar. If your photovoltaic cells, if you melt them in China, I can assure you that the life cycle analysis of that whole thing is not zero either. So it would be if you were to do it in France. That's a different thing, but that's for a different reason then. But please, you asked the question to Ernst, I think. Ernst Heller, please. How do you see it?
For me, it's very clear. Hydropower is renewable, and of course, it's always a kind of political will or the political interpretation. And as we saw in the last decades, when it comes to development of this new renewable like solar and wind, they had a quite certain lobby to develop this part of the renewable. And immediately the hydro part, the old economy or the old renewable, come in the background a little bit because they have not that lobbying to develop this new project, a new economy. And as we have discussed earlier about financing, for me it's very clear that financing plays always a crucial role in development of every project. And when we've heard already when you talk about hydropower, it's a very long pre-construction period, and then the return on investment is quite late. So they are usually the investors, the financing, the banks are not so interested to develop this long-lasting project. And you don't have to forget that you take a high risk. It was mentioned on the one side the pre-construction, but on the other side, the geological risk has to be valued. It's not always easy to develop projects very fast. You have to do a lot of investigations from the geological point of view to reduce, to mitigate risk as much as possible. And just to use the words, this is not very sexy then to develop these projects from the financing point of view. And therefore, I think hydropower has lost a little bit this reputation of this strong renewable energy.
Okay, thank you. Let's take the next question, please.
Yeah, Heindl from Germany. My question is in French. There's a fourth, maybe there's coming a fourth income stream to this hydropower. And it's about combining solar or this new renewables, the sexy renewables, and hydropower, because you can fill the gaps between no sun and the demand. And so hydropower, for example, in Norway, is the largest storage capacity that is available. And usually it is not included in the business model of a typical dam project. They are floating a little bit, but they are not combining it with solar. Is there an idea and is there a knowledge how large the impact for this type of energy storage, indirect storage, is not pumped hydro, is with hydro dams? I don't know, maybe Rossi or whoever can answer that.
I'll have a go because we just recently we are working on some opportunities where we position solar as a water-saving opportunity. It's another example of interaction between the forms, but due to climate change, perhaps, but the hydrology of some rivers it simply isn't what it used to be. There is less water, so there is capacity, electrical capacity even available, that could accommodate solar panels in some countries. Which then allow to save water, actually, when the sun shines, of course, exploiting the available connection. It's another way to look at the storage function of water. But I would agree in general that's true. We talk about Tesla building the giant factory of batteries in Nevada, but we actually have even more giant factories, which are there already, and at least on a very large scale, their economics are unbeatable. So I think there is probably some further thinking needed in order to transform this value in income streams.
I would say, and then I'll pass the mic to you, or it has already been passed on to you. But let me just comment on that. I think implicitly, many people advocating the so-called the modern renewables, they of course implicitly take into account that they can take advantage of everything that is in hydro and is available in Norway and in Austria and in Switzerland and these things if we limit it to Europe. And of course, what I sometimes think it's funny that everybody in Europe thinks that they can rely on that same type of storage. So at some moment, I think that might also run into a problem, but they should value it much, much more. I do agree wholeheartedly with you. You want to comment on that, and then I'll come to you for the question. Please.
Yeah, I would just like to really emphasize that when I said systems approach to designing hydropower in the future, then hydropower, first of all, at the utility scale, hydropower represents 97% of electricity storage on the planet. I've just been in a renewables integration session prior to this one where the word hydropower didn't get mentioned at all. So there's 97% of the service being provided by water at the moment, and it doesn't get into the discussion. And that's perhaps a reflection onto the World Energy Council that there might be some consideration to that. Renewables working together is fundamental if there is an expectation for the increased penetration of both solar and wind at the rate that it's currently happening in the world. We're going to have to make that electricity useful. At the moment, there's a quota system in several countries, and it will be an increasing number of countries in the future, where you're not able to bring new solar or new wind into the market. Look at China, look at Chile. There's quota systems now that the only way that you can bring these technologies into the system and connect with the grid is if you bring a hybrid project forwards. And that means putting water alongside the solar or alongside the wind. And this is happening at scale. In China, exactly the water conservation approach has been taken on some of the large peaking reservoirs, where hundreds, in the largest case 800 megawatts of solar PV is being fed through the same substation as a hydropower plant, delivering guaranteed firm capacity to the grid, and a premium price is being paid for that. So that's simply using the water when it's necessary, but basically optimizing the solar output. So when it's cloudy or when it's raining, you get a compensatory generation from the hydropower side. And water can be used in different places. So we don't have to look for the snow-capped mountains to think about hydropower balancing the system. There are all types of innovation around. One of them I know is a very interesting storage project that actually is in the exhibition here on how to use water from an underground perspective. But there are saltwater solutions being thought of, hydropower operating in the desert. For example, if you Google Valhalla, you'll see a 300 megawatt saltwater pump storage project balancing a 300 megawatt solar park in the middle of the desert in Chile being proposed. It's just gone through a competitive auction to try and bring that project forwards, and it's looking for investors, so it's not financially closed. But it's a demonstration that if you can use water, and if it's in limited supply, use water that isn't necessarily fresh water. You can use salt water, you can use grey water, and use it in a closed-loop system as well. So as far as I'm concerned, I don't think we're selling and communicating the role that water can play in the future.
Okay, understand. That's, of course, your role to do that, and I think you've been doing reasonably well. I'll come to you in a minute, but before we forget, and since you touched upon the systems approach, and also in the questions that were asked, it was mentioned that the multi-purpose, so let's say for balancing regulation reserves on the electricity market, but then also, then sometimes in bulk, so baseload, and then also then for water, for irrigation, for control of flooding. Now my question is, I fully will understand the systems integration aspect, but once you interlink them, for instance, isn't the water aspect, the water control aspect, the water irrigation aspect, isn't that kind of a constraint on the flexibility you have available to jump into the electricity market? Isn't that an issue that it's easy to talk about all of them, but if you combine them, can it be that indeed then the need to control a flooding or something like that is so high that your station is simply not available at that time for electricity? I give you the floor from the research perspective, and then I come to the last question there. Okay, please.
Thank you. I could not resist. That's why in Brazil we believe in have this kind of methodology and software tools to support that. So try to modeling this kind of constraints in our hydrothermal schedule models, not to see what are the room for this type of balance, because the priority in Brazil is the other uses, water supply, navigation, and so on. So from the long term to the short term, you have a kind of constraint that tries to reflect that, to see what is in reality where you get for this balance.
Thank you. I'm Gudni Hannesson from Orkustofnun, the Icelandic National Energy Authority. We had Mr. Amin visiting us, and he said, like has been said in the earlier WEC documents, that we cannot cope with the commitments according to the COP21 if we do not use the available hydropower we have in the world. That means that isn't there a time to revisit all the projects, both in the Western countries that have been abandoned because of lack of public acceptance, because we have a completely new situation now and new goals and new commitments. So it must be like that we have to revisit all these projects. And we should also be thinking about relocating energy intensive industry to the vast quantities of stranded hydropower that we have around the hydropower potential that we have around the world. So I think that hydropower has a very big role to play, and we have a very high potential to make a difference. And I would ask Richard, is the hydropower association somewhat looking at this?
Let me put the question a bit sharper. What I understand is that are you willing to, even if necessary, because the need of climate change, COP21, to go against the public, or recommend that politicians go against the public on forcing certain projects where there are some difficulties? I'm overdoing it probably a little bit, what I'm saying, but would that be a wise track?
Forcing a hydropower project through is not a good outcome. Every hydropower project is the ambassador for the next one, no matter where it is on the planet. So getting it right in terms of planning is and getting to the point where all of the stakeholders... Hydropower is everyone's business, as most people in the sector know. So having some kind of open and transparent process whereby opinions can be heard and trade-offs are going to need to be taken. You talked about this difficulty between managing fresh water and delivering flexible electricity. This requires brain cells. This requires software. This requires real experience in managing the situation. Superimpose climate change on top of that, with potentially increasing expectations on climate services coming from this infrastructure. Then it's an interesting and challenging discipline. With regard to rethinking the role of hydropower, certainly the expectations on the hydropower sector are changing. Many countries have looked at the hydropower as a done deal of something of the past, and that's a kind of closed book as far as some policy is concerned. But that book can be opened and reopened. The US has recently declared, the Department of Energy has recently declared a project where the expectation is that the capacity could double in the US, the most regulated country in the world, the most difficult thing to invest in infrastructure, I would suggest, in the world. How much of that will actually happen? We'll keep on looking at that. I would say one deterrent for doing that is the fact that 90%+ of the water storage facilities in the US have no hydro installations associated with them. Many could have small schemes recovering energy at those existing infrastructure. The trouble is that this comes back to perceptions and perhaps the politics, that the moment you put in a mini hydro project at a reservoir, all of the environmental impacts associated with the operating and existence of that reservoir tend to get pointed at the hydro operator. And that's a big deterrent for a hydropower company to come into a large piece of infrastructure for water supply or flood protection, put in a mini hydro, and then someone's all of a sudden is saying all of these environmental issues with the reservoir are down to that mini hydropower station. And that's something that really needs to be spoken about a little bit more openly. Just followed the press recently as we move towards the COP in Marrakesh. You'll see an increasing number of publications that come out talking about the greenhouse gas emissions from reservoirs. They're being grossly exaggerated, and even in some cases the examples that are given haven't even got hydropower utilities at the reservoir being spoken about. They're polluted reservoirs. They're being polluted by activities in the catchment, unrelated anthropogenic sources, but nonetheless they somehow get associated with hydropower operations. So it's a very difficult communications game. This idea of optimizing existing infrastructure is certainly something that there's an enormous expectation on that. There's 1,000 gigawatts of hydropower in existence today. All of that within the next 20 to 30 years will need to be modernized in some way. Modernized in which direction, for what services? Will it be more about water than energy? It depends on the circumstance, but all of that with the existing set of assets will need to be discussed, financed, and implemented.
Okay, thank you very much for these closing thoughts. I think we've had an interesting session. At least I have learned quite a few things. Summarizing this is almost impossible, because for every single word I'm going to say, I could just say 3-4 minutes more. Things that I just would like to mention are, I've understood that although the financing is not always trivial, etc., but it is, then it is bankable, so it is, there are possible financing schemes there. There are some things that was mentioned, auctions, a risk that indeed and remains difficult for foreign investment is the rate of exchange risk. Acceptability is a crucial point that we've just, that was the last point we've touched upon. We're very likely it's going to be one of these cases where you will need to have the support of the people somewhere in the neighborhood or it just won't fly. The third thing is then the relationship electricity-water, that indeed it is complicated. You have to look at that in a systems perspective and do the right, have the right tools in order to do that. It might be more important now these days in emerging countries than in other countries, although one shouldn't forget that in other countries like Europe, one implicitly relies on these massive water amounts that are available then in Norway, etc. So it is present. And then finally, there's something we did not touch upon, but I just would like to mention it also because it was said in the text. And I would have loved to discuss it with you, but we don't have time. That's then, it is a means of, somebody talked about, that was Mr. Rossi, I think, on the cooperation of countries. So it is a possible thing of good collaboration between countries. My reflection of my thought was maybe yes, but it could also be a source of constraints and of friction, of tension if you don't do it right. So it's again something where you have to pay very much attention. Having said that, I think you're all waiting for coffee. I understand it that we have a break. Usually, well, in principle, there was a break for 15 minutes, so it will be a break, a short break of 10 minutes because we ran over time a little bit. But please join me in thanking our speakers and give them a big round of applause. Thank you very much.